Two, in the case this is true, what kind of declaration and in what conditions would these people be subjected to? Three, if there is an intention of requesting extradition to the United States, the answer of the United States was that they cannot give any information about the Assange case, saying that this is a bilateral issue between Ecuador and the U.S. The Ecuadorian government is defending its right to protect Assange, and we have decided to grant political asylum to him.
I think that was the right thing to do.
To citizen Julian Assange, based on the request that was presented to the President of the Republic through a written document from London in June 2012, for which the Ecuadorian government has assessed Assange's situation and we can state that there is a risk that he can be persecuted politically and that he is fearing with a reason for it. So,
all right, so you get the gist of it. Now, I want to share with you the while that was going on, and I'm listening to, and again, it went on for about 30 minutes. I was following Glenn Greenwald, who is a constitutional lawyer, following his Twitter feed. And here's some of the things that he says throughout. Ecuador's foreign minister quotes 2011 British threats to Iran that they have legal obligation to protect embassy under, quote, all situations. Keep in mind, some of the cables WikiLeaks published reflected poorly on Ecuadorian government, but they don't seem to want to imprison him. It was the Ecuadorian foreign minister, I guess, who was speaking. Quote, from, and this is again, I'm reading from Glenn Greenwald's Twitter feed. If Assange is extradited to the U.S., he will not receive a fair trial. I played you that clip. The next one, the asylum process is, quote, not an abandonment of the rule of law, end quote. It is the rule of law and long has been. Next one, what bothers many people here is implicit belief that the U.S. and U.K. grant asylum against human rights violators. U.S., U.K. can't be the violators. Key fact here, Ecuador foreign minister. We tried to get Sweden to agree to no extradition to U.S. in exchange for Assange going to Sweden. They said no. All right, more from Glenn Greenwald. Assange's supporters have long advocated his going to Sweden on condition that he won't be extradited to U.S. for espionage. Assange agrees. Ecuador foreign minister, we have, and I lost my place, we have decided to grant Julian Assange political asylum. Every Assange defender I know wants the allegations in Sweden addressed. That's why he offered he'll go to Sweden if no extradition to the U.S. Again, Glenn Greenwald reiterates that point in a number of tweets. He continues, nations have right not to extradite for crimes they don't recognize. Sweden could say we won't extradite for espionage for doing journalism. And I'm sorry, that's what I believe Julian Assange was doing. I really think there's not much difference between Julian Assange publishing the things that were leaked to him and, oh, say, Daniel Ellsberg, you know, I guess, in the New York Times publishing the Pentagon Papers, right? Let's see. Again, Glenn Greenwald tweeted, Assange repeatedly offered, one, to be questioned by Swedes and UK, two, to go to Sweden if no extradition to U.S. on espionage charges. And then he said, and I love all the newfound Ecuador bashing. Where's the list of the countries that have never done anything oppressive? He can go there. And then, so typical, New York Times pretends to report on asylum, veers into a petty hit piece. Assange refused to flush the toilet. Oh, my God. And again, as Mike M. points out in the chat room, he said, I believe the only reason he has not been charged in Sweden is the risk of being held accountable for false arrest. No, that's not. The initial claim was not about rape, but the claim of sex without a condom without consent. And I think that's what it is. Anyway, that is this is breaking news. Just happened, about an hour ago. here's an article on what Ecuador tried to get Sweden to agree to before they granted asylum, and Sweden refused. Let me pull up this article. It's from the independent.ie. This is in England. The WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange could yet avoid extradition to Sweden to face sexual assault charges after Ecuadorian officials invited the Swedish authorities to its London embassy, offering to host an interview there instead. Senior Ecuadorian sources say they sent a formal request to Sweden and would be happy to facilitate questioning between Mr. Assange and the Swedish prosecutor in their West London embassy, where the WikiLeaks founder has been staying for more than a month after claiming asylum. Supporters have expressed fears that the U.S. is seeking to prosecute Mr. Assange for his involvement in the U.S. diplomatic cable leaks and would use his extradition as an opportunity to pounce. But Ecuadorian officials said they were also seeking assurances that, in the event of his extradition to Sweden, Mr. Assange would not later be sent to the U.S. There you go. I guess we'll, to be continued. First step, that's good news. Coming up in the second hour today, we'll be joined not by John Fugelsang, because John is moving today. He will be with us for a little bit tomorrow on the Randy Rhodes Show. Instead of John, I think we have a great replacement. Maysoon Zaid will join us in the second hour so we can have some fun to wrap up our week of broadcasts here on the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com. But because we don't have John in person, I thought I would share for you his latest caffeinated webisode. I guess that's what it is. It's a web series that John is doing. And this time, John Fugelsang weighs in on Afghanistan.
Afghanistan is like this reality TV show that nobody likes, nobody wants to watch. It costs way too much, and for some reason, every year it keeps getting renewed. Our troops are being shot at, women are property over there, boys are used as virtual sex toys in the culture of the Baka Baz, and it's still possible that calling Hamid Karzai an evil puppet is actually an insult to Chucky. Now, President Obama is a nice guy, but his speech this year about our armies in Afghanistan proves that even nice guys can promise to pull out when they don't mean it. And I don't blame the president. Afghanistan may be the graveyard of empires, but trying to please the Pentagon is the graveyard of Democrats. So I have two ideas how to fix it. I don't know if you'll like the first. Pretty sure you'll like the second. Remember back in May 2001 when President George W. Bush gave the Taliban $43 million thank you money after they destroyed all the opium fields? I realize if you watch Fox News, you never heard about this in the first place, but 4 months before 9/11, we gave the Taliban a great big wet kiss of a thank you present, even though they harbored terrorists, enslaved women, and were destroying their entire civilization. But man, they were being so darn awesome at being partners in the war on drugs. It was like our right-wing religious conservatives rewarding their far right-wing and extremely religious conservatives for destroying a plant that God somehow just keeps on allowing to grow all over the world. Well, the Taliban did destroy the opium fields, which wasn't all that popular with the farmers. So, here's my crazy idea. You want to keep the Taliban out of power and drag Afghanistan out of the Stone Age? Let them grow the opium again. Look, it's grown there for millennia. It was farmed in 3400 BC in Mesopotamia by Sumerians. Opium's a narcotic. It's drawn from the poppy seed sap. Its primary uses have always been medicinal and recreational. Recreational, in that we get heroin from it, and medicinal, in that it's used as a narcotic painkiller in many of the safe, legal, and oh-so-taxable pharmaceutical drugs we like so much in this country. Morphine, it's in codeine, oxycodone, hydromorphine, it's even in OxyContin, or as Rush Limbaugh calls them, party favors. Look, we're already using opium in our drugs here, and Big Pharma's getting rich off it, right? We buy it from other countries already. Why not buy it straight from the Afghan farmers? Big Pharma gets more drugs they can advertise to Americans during those TV news commercial breaks in between erectile dysfunction ads. Afghan farmers farmers get to grow what they've grown for centuries, the Taliban becomes politically and economically irrelevant, and capitalism puts terrorism out of business. Schools get built, they get cable, they get porn, they become just like us, they eat too many Cheetos, and they watch Afghan girls gone wild. Yes, there will be more heroin abuse, but there'll be less terrorism. Take a fraction of what we use to buy off warlords and use it for drug treatment. Stop sending our troops after criminals and let the free market make Afghanistan more like us. And if we keep Snooki away, they might not even hate us for it. And if that doesn't work for you, here's my second idea. Bring our troops home, right now, today, but make them leave their guns with the Afghan women. You will see that place straighten its shit out in 3 months. Hey, thanks for watching Caffeinated. Don't forget, leave a comment below. Like and share this video if you will, and be sure to subscribe. You can follow me on Twitter, like us on Facebook. We'll see you next time, and until then, I'm John Fugelsang reminding you that if Fox News really believes that more cable ratings equals more credibility, then SpongeBob SquarePants has more credibility than Fox News.
Web series called Caffeinated. Of course, come, I guess, next month, John Fugelsang will have a new primetime show on Current TV. And that's good. That's good news. Anyway, John moving today. He'll join us tomorrow for a little bit on Randy Rhoads Show, okay? All right, what else is there to talk about? We've got dueling song parodies this morning. Yes, we do. And all right, so we did Ecuador and Julian Assange, yes. We did John Fugelsang. The fallout from Joe Biden's latest, verbal diarrhea continues. And if I didn't make myself clear yesterday, yeah, what Joe Biden said was kind of stupid. I mean, for those of you who, you know, have been sleeping for the last 48 hours.
And look at their budget. And what they're proposing. Romney wants to let the, he said in the first 100 days, he's going to let the big banks once again write their own rules. Unchain Wall Street. They're going to put you all back in chains.
You know, I wonder, I really wonder if that was on, I hate to go there and talk teleprompters, but I wonder if that line was on the teleprompter or, you know, if Joe went off script. The thing is, and I don't have this clip, I'll have to find it before this afternoon, where Joe Biden says, the thing that's different about, me and the other side, I guess, is I say what I mean. So he doubled down on it. And he did explain later on that, he said chains, maybe if it was, if he'd used the word shackles, and used, Paul Ryan's own words, it would have been different.
Here's what Congressman Ryan said. He said, we believe a renewed commitment to limited government will unshackle our economy. The Speaker of the House said, use the word unshackle as well, referring to their proposals. The last time these guys unshackle the economy, to use their term, they put the middle class in shackles. That's how we got where we are. 9 million jobs lost, wage stagnation, $16 trillion in wealth you all lost, in your home equity, in your 401ks,
yep,
in your pension plans.
Say it, Joe.
You're the ones that got nailed. All of America, except a very few. And I'm told when I made that comment earlier today in Danville, Virginia, the Romney campaign put out a tweet, put out a tweet, went on the airway saying, Biden, he's outrageous, insane, that I think I said instead of unshackled, unchained, or anyway, outrageous to say that. That's what we've had. I'm using their own words.
Their own words.
I got a message for them. If you want to know what's outrageous, it's their policies. And the effects of their policies on middle-class America. That's what's outrageous. That's what's outrageous.
No shit.
I think it's outrageous to continue to give companies tax breaks to outsource rather than tax breaks to insource. To make massive cuts in education, massive cuts in college aid, massive cuts in Medicaid,
yep,
throwing 19 million people off who desperately need health care. off of Medicare.
Yep. That is outrageous.
1 million seniors. How many of you know somebody in a home right now who is getting extended care? 8 will get you 10. They're there because they have Medicaid. What happens when they do this? That's outrageous.
First thing cut.
You want to know what's outrageous?
Yep.
Massive changes. Massive cuts to Social Security for future generations. That's the hard proposal.
Exactly. That's what's outrageous. Yet the right is freaking out. You know, they got their faux news and now they got their faux outrage. I know it's a little long, but boy, Jon Stewart was awesome on this topic last night.
Ryan's been getting an awful lot of media attention. Well, Joe Biden is not going to sit back and let that tenderfoot soak up all his ink.
Romney wants to let he said in the first 100 days, he's going to let the big banks once again write their own rules. Unchain Wall Street. They're going to put y'all back in chains.
Yeah.
What? I'm just saying. You're going to be slaves again, is what I'm saying. Y'all. I said y'all. That means you, the black people. Hey, you're going to be slaves. What? Hey, champ, how you doing? Okay, that's bad.
Yeah, but.
But in his defense, for a guy who has in the past exhorted a man in a wheelchair to stand up for what he believes in, referred to someone's still living parent as their late beloved parent.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And once authorized a $6 billion federal expenditure for a dinosaur egg that turned out to be a bowling ball.
That's not good.
Now, if you believe in the heat of this campaign season that this clearly inappropriate statement from the vice president is going to cause a minor stir, you have not been paying attention to this campaign season. Cue up Republican DEFCON 8.
Yes. This operation is one of the most hateful, divisive operations that we've ever seen in this country.
And brought this campaign to a low that we've not seen in years.
Where is the decency? I'm a little shocked.
Mr. President, take your campaign of division and anger and hate back to Chicago and let us get about rebuilding and reuniting America.
Okay, two things. First, as a general rule, I find it helps not to frame a plea for national unity by insulting a major city within that nation.
That would help.
Mr. President, we must all come together no matter what those sacks of human feces from the metropolitan anus that is Chicago would have us do. They can my deep dish, no disrespect. How you doing? And second, are the Republicans really in the moral high ground position on the issue of divisive anger and hate vis-a-vis their opponent? Let's face facts. Chicago doesn't even appear to be the only area of America not invited to the Republican Unity Party.
Liberal haven that is known as New York State.
The Upper East Side.
Liberal Madison Avenue.
Massachusetts.
East Coast. Hollywood.
California.
Chicago.
Martha's Vineyard.
Berkeley, which is a well-known liberal institution.
It's a communist place.
Yeah, it's a communist place. Uh-huh. Fidel Castro is the dean of the school. They got a gulag. I understand the cafeteria has a meal plan. So we know what areas of America are not welcome in America. What Americans are not worthy of inclusion in this unified Ramerica?
Union and trial lawyer liberal.
Ivory tower professors.
His union thugs.
The moocher class.
Professionally unemployed people.
Poor people.
Radical environmentalists.
Teachers, just like Barack Obama, are against competition.
Oh,
these
my God.
Teachers believe in the redistribution of information. It's communism. Wow, I had no idea how hateful and divisive these groups you are describing are. If we could only get rid of teachers, lawyers, unions, and poor people, we could unite.
the remaining less than half of this country.
This is, I mean, seriously.
Now obviously, since we're not supposed to go to college and be around these teachers, where can I learn more about the left's divisive and angry rhetoric?
Unhinged, exposing liberals gone wild.
How Islam and the left sabotage America.
How the left swift-boated America.
Liberal media's attack on Christianity.
Demonic, how the liberal mob is endangering America.
48 liberal lies about American history.
Liberal fascism.
Control freaks.
Celebutards. The Hollywood hacks, limousine liberals, and pandering politicians who are destroying America.
Oh, my God. Yeah. That latest was a book from Edna Pizer.
I imagine I can find all these books at my local Barnes & Awful. Or perhaps you'd prefer shopping at Totally Closed Borders.
Yeah. All right, I like that one.
Republicans really that blind? This is the truth. You know, the rhetoric on all sides can be hateful sometimes, but are the Republicans really that blind to the depth of their own vitriol? You won't believe how blind. Blinder than a man Joe Biden would publicly challenge to a staring contest.
Name one prominent Republican who comes close to what, like, the Alan Graysons, the Harry Reids, the Joe Bidens come up with and spew to the American public. I can't think of one prominent Republican who talks the way that they talk.
Wow. Wowie, wow, wow.
Let me ask you a question. Does the lake behind you have reflective properties? If so, you may find the answer to your riddle.
Yeah.
And if not...
If not...
Our opponent is someone who sees America as imperfect enough to pal around with terrorists.
Come on, Barack Obama, who are you palling around with now? Jan Brewer has the cojones that our president does not have.
Nancy Pelosi is a dingbat.
A left-wing liberal socialist.
Washington elite.
They're like a bunch of dead fish.
Their radical agenda. Left agenda.
All that pocololo smoking and that cocaine snorting and what he ate. Fido.
So you don't know of any prominent Republicans who spew divisive vitriol? There can only be two explanations for that. One, not even Sarah Palin believes she is a prominent Republican anymore. Or two, Sarah Palin can no longer hear herself speak. You can read about it in my new book, The Luckiest Woman in America.
Boy, Jon Stewart hit the nail on the head last night. These people, it's the old, you know, I'm rubber, you're glue. And in psychological terms, it's projection. You know, the things they do, they accuse the other side of doing. No, you know what? There ain't no contest here. Wow. All right, still to come this hour, dueling song parodies. One kind of critical of President Obama. The other one says he needs a second term. So stick around. We'll get to those next. I'm Nicole Sandler at His Radio. Or not.
Hear how the Koch brothers are profiting from a load of corporate welfare moonshine today on Hightower Radio. Question. If you mix a cocktail of black liquor, biofuels, diesel, and a generous splash of tax subsidies, then have it shaken vigorously by Senator Mike Crapo and served in a golden goblet by corporate lobbyists, what do you call it? Answer. Koch brothers moonshine. Black liquor, a byproduct of the papermaking process, is an alcoholic sludge that paper mills use to fuel their operations. Fine. Creative, even. But then, the paper giants turn from creative to cabal, teaming with Senator Crapo and other practitioners of the legislative black arts to turn their sludge into a slick tax loophole. In 2007, Crapo and a covey of corporate lobbyists quietly made their liquor eligible for a subsidy meant to help wean America off of oil by encouraging the production of a biofuel gasoline mix to power cars and trucks. Not so fine. One, vehicles can't use mill sludge as a fuel. Two, rather than mixing biofuel to their sludge, the paper makers add diesel. So these sneaks are siphoning off billions of dollars from a clean fuels program by making a dirty fuel dirtier. Who's profiting from this load of moonshine? Right at the top are the infamous far-right-wing Koch brothers. These multi-billionaire political extremists have been financing everything from corporate front groups to the Tea Party in a relentless effort to impose their plutocratic agenda on our country. One major way they pay for this onslaught is by tapping directly into the blatant corporate welfare of the black liquor loophole. The Coke industrial empire includes Georgia-Pacific, one of America's largest paper makers, and it's the happy recipient of up to $1 billion a year from the perverted biofuel subsidy. This is Jim Hightower saying, a dirty windfall from a dirty fuel to underwrite dirty politics. It all stinks.
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you, the Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Okay, just trying to help someone out on Twitter who can't listen today. I'll get back to him in a moment. But I promised you dueling song parodies. The first one up, I think, is getting a little more traction online than the second one. So up first, we have the, hold on, I got to find it first. Come on, where are you? Okay. And this one takes a little bit of, a little more explanation than the other one. But the Broadway show Les Miserables, has a song in it called One Day More. Now, for those of us who are not that up on Les Mis, I mean, I love musicals, but Les Mis was never one of, it's just not one that I was into. So I don't really know this song, but let's begin the dueling song parodies with this one. Instead of One Day More, it's called One Term More. And, the beginning of it has some credits and stuff. So I will read them to you. Those of you watching on the Ustream, you just get the, you get the video itself. Here we go.
One term more, a time to celebrate democracy, repeal Republican hypocrisy. This man who would unseat Barack's a bleak choice at the ballot box, one term
a
more.
GOP perdition bound, all sense of right and wrong eroded.
One term more,
with laws that let them stand their ground. Republicans are locked and loaded.
Contraception's now a sin.
Screwing GM in the clutch.
Incivility's a virtue.
Oh, the
budget scrubs.
Ultrasounds and speculums.
To the dark side they've succumbed.
Soon election day will dawn.
We were meant to hold this seat
at the ballot box of freedom.
Unemployment in retreat.
Now the battle lines are drawn.
Of teachers, firemen, and cops. One more day to resolution. We'll defeat those fetid nuts. We are fed up with pernicious talk of prostitutes and sluts.
Watching throwing up, knitting malcontent, drinking all the teas made them incontinent. Dissembling persists, divisiveness prevails. Calling colleagues communists is off the rails. Listen to them spew. Feminazi rage, misogynistic rants from the Jurassic Age.
To Obama said.
Obstructions, why we gridlock on the kill.
Healthcare is a right, Medicare's a must. Don't let the Republicans betray that trust. Speaking of betrayal, bullied by his peers, tackled to the ground, screams her name to tears. Hunting down the queer, cut him off his hair. Spike the ball, you can't recall if he was there.
It's his character we question. Don't let him down election day.
So there's the parody of the Les Mis song, and I don't even know, that one didn't get me because I'm not a Les Mis fan, you know. I wish they had the lyrics transcribed. Oh, wait a minute, duh. Okay, here are the lyrics. Let me I'll share them with you. It's one term more. A time to celebrate democracy, repeal Republican hypocrisy. This man who would unseat Barack's oblique choice at the ballot box. One term more. A GOP perdition bound, all sense of right and wrong eroded. One term more. With laws that let them stand their ground, Republicans are locked and loaded. Contraception's now a sin, screwing GM in the clutch. Incivility's a virtue, homophobic, out of touch. Filibusters, budget scrums, ultrasounds, and speculums. To the dark side, they've succumbed. Soon election day will dawn. We were meant to hold this seat at the ballot box of freedom, unemployment's in retreat. Now the battle lines are drawn, and Detroit's back on its feet. Will you take your place with me? Now the time is near, one term more. One more day to re-election, and until the music stops, we will fight to save the jobs of teachers, firemen, and cops. One more day to resolution, we'll defeat those fetid nuts. We are fed up with pernicious talk of prostitutes and sluts. Watch them throwing up, minting malcontent, drinking all that teas made them incontinent. Dissembling persists, divisiveness prevails, calling colleagues communists is off the rails. Listen to them spew feminazi rage, misogynistic rants from the Jurassic Age. To Obama's second inning, he'll drive home another run. Norma Rae, Let Sisters Sing. Rosa Parks, Let Freedom Ring. For Obama's just beginning, yes, the West Wing will be won. And we'll get the Dream Act done. My place is here, I vote with you, one term more. Emboldened by star-spangled myth, we want a Jedi, not a Sith. Petty partisan obstructions, why we've gridlocked on the Hill. Healthcare is a right, Medicare is a must. Don't let rogue Republicans betray that trust. Speaking of betrayal, bullied by his peers, tackled to the ground, screams turned into tears. Hunting down the queer, cutting off his hair, spiked the ball, yet can't recall if he was there. It's in his character, we question. Mom, apple pie, and Chevrolet, don't let him down this election day. That's when we will determine what our God in heaven has in store. One more term, otra vez, one term more. All right, so that's the Les Mis parody. Very, I got to say, very, very well done by a bunch of Broadway stars who really can sing, right? And again, I guess you need to... you know, for people who are fans of Les Mis, my friend Asher Huey loves it. I mean, a lot of, you know, people love it. All right. Now, for the more popular music fans among us and those who are slightly more, shall we say, critical of President Obama. Now, again, let me reiterate, given the choice between the two, there's no question I will vote for Obama. I will vote against Romney. But here's the other in our dueling parody songs today. This comes from, I don't even know who this comes from. Just New Productions is who it comes from. All right, you ready? I'm not even going to intro it. Just, we'll go.
What began here. As a whisper has now swelled to a chorus that cannot be ignored. Yeah. That will not be deterred. That will ring out across this land as a hymn that will heal this nation, repair this world, make this time different than all the rest. Yes, we can.
Now and then I think of that election day, November. When you won, I felt so happy I could die. Chugged a fifth, paraded in the street, and I thank God that Palin wasn't Veep. It felt like change, and it's a hope I still remember.
Change will not come if we wait for some other person, or if we wait for some other time. We are the ones we've been waiting for. We are the change that we seek.
You can get addicted to a certain kind of message. This is change we can believe in, yes we can. But college ended, had to pay my rent. At least you're the first gay president. But the change I got was that I moved in with my mother. Because you won and then you cut me off. Now your speeches never soar as high as unemployment. You took Obamacare so far, but you left me like a dog strapped on Romney's car. Even the shirt that was on my back is owned by China, being arbitraged by Goldman Sachs. Just sent in a predator drone, 'cause now you're not Obama that I used to know. Now you're not Obama that I used to know. Now I need Obama that I used to know.
Sometimes I think that Peace Prize winners shouldn't have a kill list, but you dumped Bin Laden in the sea, so maybe it's all good. Said you'd rouse my economy. Your big package didn't stimulate me. Still my American idol, though. When you sang I'm so in love with you, Obama, that I used to know.
But you won and then you cut me off.
chose Guantanamo and we got nothing. Relocation shouldn't be that hard. Just strap the prisoners in on top of Romney's car. No, I don't need you to legalize. Just keep the feds away from folks like you when you were younger. There's nothing that you didn't talk. But now that's just Obama that I used to know.
That I used to know.
Obama.
That I used to know.
Obama.
That I used to know. In 2012 I need Obama that I used to know.
He's a jackass.
What began as a whisper has now swelled.
I like that one better. I'm sorry. First of all, I like the song better, number one. And, you know, this one is a little more honest, I think. Pretty and funny and very funny. The thing is, you know what? I can't play that on Randy Rhoads' show. And he, well, number one, it's too long. I just, you know. But this morning, I get a tweet from somebody. Let me see if I can't find it. Here we go. Who says, I love you, but the first guest on Randy yesterday was too whiny to listen to. Had to turn it off. I, like Randy, hate whiners. And I'm thinking, my first guest yesterday was a whiner. My first guest yesterday was Chris Hedges. Chris Hedges is not a whiner. He's somebody who has legitimate beefs. And I wrote back, I'm like, yeah, Chris Hedges? What? And she writes again, I didn't like him blaming the president for evicting occupiers. That's a lie. He's still stuck on the public option. Ugh. See, and that is the problem. Just because you criticize the president for things that he's doing wrong does not make you a whiner. This is a whiner. You want to hear a whiner? Here's a whiner. This is a whiner.
I know it's not a question.
Not her.
That
the
is
woman
welcomed,
answering the question here
must be asked because a lot of people still are asking why not be transparent and release more than the 2010 and the estimates for 2011.
Have you seen how we're attacked?
They
have you
attack
seen what's
happened?
Us.
It's been in the press quite a bit. Now, are you angry that it's been in the press? I mean, should you not be questioned about your finances?
We have been very transparent
to what's
legally required.
Oh, what's
of us.
Legally required?
But.
Yeah. But
the more we release, the more we get attacked. The more we get questioned, the more
we
get pushed. And so we have done what's legally required, and there's going to be no more. There's going to be no more.
You people get no more.
Given. And there's
no
a
more
reason
for
that,
people.
And that's because of how
mean.
What happens as soon as we release anything. Mitt's
they're
financial disclosures when he was governor are huge. If people want to really look and see any question they have, mm-hmm. The other thing they have to understand is that Mitt is as honest. His integrity is just golden.
Right. Yeah.
We pay our taxes. We are absolutely, beyond paying our taxes, we also give 10% of our
income. Because it's required by the Mormon Church.
So, you know, we have no issues that way, and the only reason we don't disclose anymore
is, they're so
you know,
mean.
We just become a bigger target.
They're mean.
So it's because you'll just continue to face more questions.
That, it'll just give them more ammunition.
Because there's more ammunition in there. Yeah, you people.
Why you gotta be so mean?
Yeah. All right. Let's see. What else? Oh, in the biggest stunner in, you know, for political watchers everywhere, Chuck Todd, hell froze over yesterday. Chuck Todd was talking to the governor of Ohio, Branstad, who was repeating the right-wing talking points about, you know, Obama killing the work requirements for welfare. Listen to this.
This problem I think a lot of people have is a massive expansion of the food stamp program. We have more people on food stamps than ever before. They've liberalized the rules, and a lot of people think they need to tighten that up. Just like we reformed welfare in the 1990s, now the Obama administration is trying to undo the work requirement. We think that we need to, instead of trying to put more people.
Well, wait a minute. Governor Brain said, I can't let that go. They haven't done that. That's the biggest difference. They haven't undone the work requirements.
Is the stamp program.
I'm trying to understand. You went after the work requirements. I'm trying to go back. You leveled a charge about the welfare work requirements. It turns out that's not true. Where did you get your information?
It absolutely is. I was one of the governors that helped get it. And when we passed it, it was designed not to be waived. And now the President of the United States has, by executive order in July, weakened that, which was very effective. We've reduced
the waivers are for state governors. The waivers are for you.
By 50%, Governor Tommy Thompson was the leader of this in Wisconsin. He just won the primary yesterday. You're going to hear more about this because this president never supported work for welfare, and now he's trying to weaken it.
But again, it was a waiver for governor. He's not doing anything. If governors weaken it to a certain point, the federal government yanks the waiver.
Well, here's our concern is you've got some liberals that are going to try to
use that, to a brick wall.
What we think is the effective welfare reform that we pass on a bipartisan basis with governors like John Engler and Tommy Thompson and I working for it in the 90s has worked effectively. Liberals have always hated it. Obama is playing to his liberal base by trying to weaken that. And we think that's wrong. We think it's one of the most effective things that's been done in the last two decades, and we need to do similar things.
Every charge that has been leveled about this welfare reform order that the president signed, that every accusation that has been leveled by some Republicans have been proven to be not true.
Well, the fact of the matter is the president did it. He didn't have to take
No, that's not the fact of the matter.
To weaken the strong work requirement that was passed back
it
in the
It doesn't weaken it. It gives the states.
Was president when I was governor before.
Okay.
He did it. He did it because he's never supported the work requirement.
Oh my
and
God.
And the fact of the matter is,
the work requirement is still there, Governor.
It's there. Well, we
it's
don't
still
want
there.
To see waivers
it's still there.
Of this because once you start waivers,
that's
how we got to welfare reform. We insisted on having work requirements. And then we got a national law, and we want to keep it in place.
And he finally gives up. He's like,
not have it
he finally gives up.
I will leave it there. Governor Branstad, Republican from Iowa, on this day that we're focusing on the drought. We got a little sidetracked there on welfare when we were talking about the farm bill. But we'll leave it there. Governor, thanks
very much. Oh, my God. You know, I never thought I'd say it, but good for you, Chuck Todd. Oy. I read the news today. All right, time now for the news. For that, we check in with the Talk Radio News Service, talkradionews.com. I think we've got Bob Nay today. Is that you?
Yes, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing okay.
Good. Is there any actual news today, or is it all just mudslinging?
Mudslinging?
Yeah.
But we could just, you know, talk about nice things, I guess.
Like? What?
Yeah, there is some news.
Okay.
The children of illegal immigrants, who we can deem illegal immigrants, have lined up in the thousands. And, of course, that was the news story yesterday. But there's some misinformation in the sense that people are saying an executive order. This was not an executive order. It is a policy change. But the ability to do this has actually been on the books for quite a few years. So the administration has said, you know, you can go ahead and start to register. And I think anybody who thought, well, you know, they'll put a stop to this. I mean, thousands of people, 13,000 alone lined up around the block in Chicago.
Right.
So it looks like the process is underway, and, you know, they'll be assessing their ability to sign up for this
Although
program.
Now, Jan Brewer, of course, has to be the party pooper here. Reading from colorlines.com, this is they write, on the same day that the Obama administration opened up its application process for the largest deportation relief in a generation, Arizona Governor Jan Brewer insisted on reminding the nation of her state's hallmark, anti-immigrant hatred. In an executive order signed on Wednesday, Brewer stated that Arizona's undocumented youth granted deportation relief will be barred from accessing any of the concomitant public benefits, namely an Arizona driver's license or public ID. So, you know, I'm sorry. This is ridiculous.
Well, you know, this really will beg the point. And so maybe a not so positive thing will beg the point that at the end of the day, the Congress is going to have to, you know, we have 50 states and this is a national change of policy, and then you have a state saying something else. So, you know, the Congress eventually, no matter who likes what side of this, is going to have to weigh in. This is a federal issue, and each state can do as they please, but at the end of the day, the Congress is someday going to have to address this once and for all.
Yep. And you're right, Bob. I'm glad you pointed out this was not an executive order. This actually came from it came from DHS, didn't it? Or
It's been there, and it's probably, I mean, it was there under Bush, I assume. It has been there. And at times, the Bush administration did different things. Sometimes they pursued people, sometimes they didn't.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not an executive order. But I think that the states, for example, Arizona and others, starting down maybe some other path, will show that, you know, we've got things in progress, so the Congress is eventually going to have to sit down and try to see what works nationally.
Yeah, but this with this Congress, nothing's going to happen.
Nothing. This one can't do anything.
It's pretty sad.
Did you see about John Boehner and the Tea Party?
Yeah, he called some of them knuckle draggers, didn't he?
Well, they are not happy with him. They've got him crying, practically. And he defended Paul Ryan's TARP vote, and then the Tea Party came out and just went crazy on him and said, this is what's the problem with Congress, you know, people like Boehner. So I thought it was quite interesting.
Yeah, you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens in November, because the only way anything is going to get done is if those knuckle draggers are voted out, because they're willing to, you know, sacrifice our good faith and credit yet again. There's going to be another vote on the debt ceiling, isn't there, before the election?
Well, you know, yeah, they have extended the actual, you know, budget process way into, they'll take votes, but they've extended the process into next year,
okay,
which did not make any of the conservative element happy, but gave breathing time, no matter who's the president of the United States. A new president can't come in and do it in the first month.
Right.
You know, or the existing president.
Right.
So, you know.
So what would happen, Bob, and just, you know, consider the unthinkable for a moment, that Romney and Ryan get in, and, you know, the Tea Partiers remain in their, you know, huge, big group in the House and even take over the Senate. All right, let's just, you know, talk about Armageddon here. Are they not going to vote to increase the debt limit, the debt ceiling?
Well, you know, it's been done under Republican presidents, just never with any hoopla. I mean,
right.
I think I voted maybe six times to do it myself. You
right,
know,
and it was never a big deal, but because
it was never a deal.
Right, but because the Republicans have drawn this line in the sand and will not pass anything that Obama asked for, they have now convinced the lemmings in this nation, you know, the Fox viewers, that raising the debt ceiling is a bad thing. You know, basically telling our creditors that we will pay the bills that we've already incurred is something we shouldn't do. So how are they going to then go ahead and do it?
They'll convince the advocacy groups that, you know, the real work is in the Appropriations Committee and how we spend the money and don't pay attention to the debt ceiling. That's what I predict will
happen.
And
so, you know, they'll say, do as I say, not as I do?
Yeah, and you know, because the actual truth is, you know, the spending is done through the Appropriations Committee. The debt ceiling was always okay, we raised the debt ceiling, so what? Now it's become a mantra of, you know, how tough are you and how are you going to toe the line. So I think that they'll have to increase the debt ceiling, okay, or they bring the entire ball of wax to a halt that nobody wants to really see. So I think they'll convince, if that would happen, your scenario, you know, hypothetical, I think they would convince them that, well, the real work's in how we spend the money.
Right, and hopefully it will never get to that point. I mean, yesterday we saw this big USA Today Suffolk University poll that showed if everybody who was eligible to vote in this nation actually voted, Obama would win re-election in a landslide.
Yeah, the actual polls are showing that some of the people that are going to stay home are actually Obama supporters, the vast majority.
Yeah, it's really, really kind of sad. I mean, people need to go and vote, especially right now when the Republicans are doing everything they can to make sure we don't go to the polls and vote.
I think it's good to have voting no matter who's winning.
Yep.
You know, you need to have the best amount of people to vote. People die to vote in other countries, literally.
Exactly. And people died here for our right to vote. I mean, really.
Right.
And here we go. All right. And is the, do you, Bob Ney, a Republican, I don't know if you still are, but you were. Mm-hmm. What did you think about it? Was Joe Biden's chains comment so god awful, like that we're for the to spur the outrage we're seeing from the right?
Well, you know, for disclaimer purposes here, you know, I know Joe Biden. I served with him. I worked on foreign policy items with his office. I like Joe Biden.
I do too.
I'm not a Biden a hater. Mm-hmm. I don't think Biden had a racial motive in doing this. Joe Biden is Joe Biden.
It's Joe Biden, right?
And it would have been better if he didn't say it, to be honest with you.
Right.
It would have been just better. But anybody knowing Joe Biden knows he does not have racist bone in his body.
Right. Okay. All right. And this feigned outrage from the right is pretty insane, isn't it?
Joe Biden will just tend to be unfiltered. And so is my friend Ellen Ratner. So. Yeah, that happens.
Yes, it does. All right. Anything else going on today we need to know about?
That's it. Everybody's gearing up for the conventions. The candidates are everywhere, and the TV ads are running relentlessly, especially in my home state of Ohio.
Yes, they are, and especially here in Florida.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Bob Ney from the Talk Radio News Service. TalkRadioNews.com is where you find him. By the way,
who do you love?
Who do you love?
I
may have to put together a Joe Biden's greatest hits for this afternoon and the Randy Rhoads Show. Just because. Yeah, maybe. All right. All right. Let's take a break. We'll come back on the other side with Maysoon Zaid here on the Nicole Sandler Show Radio or not.
At goatsfortheoldgoat.com, you can buy a goat to fight hunger in South Sudan and help recently liberated slaves from the north come to their peaceful home in the south. We'll send you a certificate acknowledging your gift and a photo of your goat with its recipient upon delivery. Even better, you can make the donation in the name of your special someone as a present they'll never forget. So visit goatsfortheoldgoat.com today and help fight hunger this holiday season. That's goatsfortheoldgoat.com.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Jill Fitzsimmons. The right-wing media have repeatedly claimed that President Obama stole $700 billion from Medicare. Here, for example, is Steve Ducey.
Is the fact that this president, to pay for his Obamacare, is actually raiding the Medicare fund to the tune of $716 billion.
Yes. However, when CNN's Soledad O'Brien was confronted with this right-wing falsehood in an interview with John Sununu, she pushed back.
Pratic analysis.
Let me finish. There's independent analysis. FactCheck.com, the CBO, and CNN has also done its own independent analysis. And name-calling to me and somehow acting as if by you repeating a number of $716 billion that you can make that stick when that figure is being stolen from Medicare, that's not true. You can't just repeat it and make it true.
For this story and more, visit MediaMatters.org or follow us on Twitter at MMFA.
Okay, listen. Somebody has got to get serious.
Well, I think the sky's the limit on what we can gouge you for a gallon of gas. And long as we don't have any oversight or regulation, Wall Street can speculate all they want. And there's not a goddamn thing you can do about it.
You hear about alternatives, right? Wind, solar,
I think that'll work on a large scale, but it won't be any more affordable. The reality is, we're big oil, and what that means is, we can ram our fists so far up your ass we can tickle your tonsils. I mean, what are you gonna do? Write an angry letter to President Jell-O?
We gotta get on this now.
Get on this, lady. At Chevron, our scientists are hard at work developing a mechanical dildo that rapes you as you bend over to fill the tank.
Chevron, gas prices high as the sky. You won't complain. What is The Boca Show?
I don't know what it is, but it's moving.
Sounds different than you would think. Britt Reed of the Daily Sentinel. Before getting the check, Larry King said,
the worst talk radio I've ever heard in my life.
After getting the check, Larry King says,
that is great radio.
The Boca Show, Sundays at 4 and 7 on 1470 WNN. Archive shows available at thebocashow.com and soflowradio.com. The Boca Show, for when you get bored.
The George Rodriguez Show.
Who?
I said the George Rodriguez Show. You don't know George Rodriguez?
Wasn't he the guy that filled in for Neil Rogers?
Yes. That George Rodriguez.
What's he like?
Oh, he's a short little Cuban fella. Kind of funny looking.
Well, when's he on?
12 to 3, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on SoFloRadio.com and SoFloRadio.net. The George Rodriguez Show is much more than
adequate.
Is Antonin Scalia ignorant, forgetful, or just a supreme liar? You can be the judge today on Hightower Radio. Antonin Scalia, the hardest of hardcore corporate ideologues on the Supreme Court, is nothing if not cocksure that every cock-a-doodle-doo coming out of his head is absolutely correct. In a recent CNN interview, the lifelong resident of laissez-faire land unleashed a torrent of logically perverse and factually wrong statements. Without blushing, for example, Scalia declared that, quote, the court is not at all a political institution. Perhaps he doesn't recall his participation in assorted, openly partisan events with Republican officials and such billionaire politicos as the Koch brothers. Also, asked directly about Bush versus Gore, the most political decision in court history, Scalia blurted out, get over it. No, sir. The 2000 case was a court coup led by you to usurp the people's vote and autocratically install the corporate candidate George W. Bush as president. Yet, Scalia blamed Gore for bringing the case into federal court, apparently forgetting that, in fact, Bush was the one who ran to the federal courthouse. Still, no regrets, Scalia said, asserting that a subsequent press survey showed that Bush would have won even if the court had allowed a statewide recount. No, again, sir, the survey actually showed that Gore would have come out ahead. And what about the court's grossly political Citizens United edict, declaring that, hocus pocus, corporations have a First Amendment right to spend unlimited sums of their corporate cash to buy our elections? Turning completely screwy, Scalia blathered that, quote, Thomas Jefferson would have said the more speech the better. Excuse me, but no, certainly not for moneyed corporations, which he warned should have no role in our elections. This is Jim Hightower saying, whether he's ignorant, forgetful, or just a supreme liar, Scalia is not fit to be on our Supreme Court.
If you like these feisty pops of populism that Hightower zings out on the airwaves, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter provides the in-depth lowdown on what the greed heads of Wall Street and the boneheads of Washington are doing to us behind the scenes. With Hightower's saucy Texas humor and truth-telling populist perspective, the lowdown literally can lift you up. And get this, you can have the lowdown delivered to your mailbox or email each month for only $15 a year. Yes, 12 issues, only 15 bucks. Check it out, HightowerLowdown.org.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Greg Palast, I realized as we were talking that actually we were supposed to do this on Wednesday, so thank you so much for bearing with me.
Well, I am thrilled that we're doing that. You've jumped the other characters. Because, Nicole,
too.
I just think that your show is brilliant, and I want to thank you because my stuff may be prime time and quick, but here I keep slamming into the electronic Berlin Wall, and you have snuck me across and into the information stream. And I hope that your listeners are aware of how important and precious your program is. So I want to thank you.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
All right. You know, we will have Craig Palast back on the show pretty soon because he's got a new book coming out, really a new book all about, they want to steal your vote. And they are. All right. Let's get Maysoon Zaid on the line now, shall we? Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I tried to be quiet because I'm always really loud when I say hi to you.
No, you're perfect.
I'm being tame.
You're being tame? Oh, not for long, I hope.
Well, I wouldn't want you to think that I was trying to kill you.
You are a Palestinian and I'm a Jew and you want to be, a Jew killer, according to the critics. Yeah.
I'm apparently on a team. I didn't know.
You're on a team.
I think. Okay. Yeah. I think it's part of the Paralympics. Josh Trevino, who apparently just got a job at The Guardian, decided to say that I was on team kill all the Jews.
Oh, my
God. I think it's part of the Paralympics because I'm not as good as Oscar. I can't do the real Olympics.
Right.
But I didn't sign up for the team. I wasn't aware. And, I'm really afraid that I might kill you during this interview.
Oh.
So I'm trying to be very peaceful,
okay,
which is difficult for a savage like myself.
Of course. I understand. Well, I've been forewarned. So thank you for that. Who is this guy? I'm sorry. I don't know.
Okay, so I didn't know who he was either, and I made the mistake of thinking he was a journalist, which was bad research on my part. I'll admit that. Mm-hmm. But apparently he's an opinion writer.
Oh.
And The Guardian USA just hired him, and people were making like a really big deal about it because apparently he said that Alice Walker should be shot in the face, and that's not a direct quote.
Oh, my
it's
God.
Like he... Basically, he was controversial because he was cheering on the IDF when the whole flotilla incident happened in Gaza.
God.
And, you know, unarmed civilians were killed. And he said they should be. And he said that he had disregard for the fact that they were U.S. citizens because they were aiding terrorism. And he implicated all the people in Gaza as being, you know, part of this terrorist regime of Hamas and whatever else. Now, I didn't discuss any of this with this guy.
Right.
I just saw him referencing Wikipedia to you know, kind of back his idea that everyone in Gaza should die.
Yeah.
And I wrote back, I said, what kind of journalist sources Wikipedia? And then he came back and said that he wasn't a journalist and that he writes for an opinion page. And I said, okay, I'm sorry. I take it back. You're not a journalist. Please go on and spew your hate.
Right.
Free.
Oh, boy.
And then
he
wrote, ironic coming from you, from Team Kill All the Jews.
Oh,
and I was like,
God.
I didn't get that at all. The funny side apart,
yeah.
First of all, I feel ridiculous having to defend myself because right after that tweet, someone else said to me, well, just say that you don't want to kill Jews and Israelis and clear it up. And I was like, what the hell? And I did. And I did before I caught myself. And I regret that, but I'm not the type that deletes tweets unless I totally type something wrong.
Right,
and
if
it's like bad for the disabled people and makes Peter Singer want to put us to sleep.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I'm having that week. So I just I just think that it's really dangerous because, A, this man knew nothing about me. He had done no research whatsoever. His assumption that I wanted to harm people of a certain faith came from the fact that I had an Arab name or that I was commenting on a comment about Gaza. One of these two things. He had obviously done no research about me because I find like it's heinous to come up to someone like me who's constantly like talking about how I'm secular and how I'm for equal rights. I'm not going to parade out my Jewish friends. It's like I'm just not going to do it for them.
Right.
At the same time, that does stuff to my career because people believe what they read and they don't research and they do think he's a journalist because he writes for The Guardian. They don't think it's an opinion. And you can't throw around something that dangerous without knowing anything about the person you're saying it to. What if the next time I go through the Israeli airport so that I can pick up this child that we've been trying to adopt for the past 2 years, they tell me, oh, here it says that you're for killing Jews.
Right.
Which is something that I like. That is a horrifying thing to say to someone. And this is the atmosphere that we're living in where it's okay to say these things with absolutely no retribution. But people who are speaking fact are trying to like get out of the Ecuadorian embassy. I don't know what's going on.
No, but here's the thing. You know, being an opinion writer as opposed to a journalist doesn't give you license to lie and to slander others. Right? I mean, it doesn't. Look, I'm not a journalist either, but I'm not going to go and, you know, and say, you know, Alan West wants to kill all the Jews, which is just, you know, I can't stand the guy. But at least I know that's not fact, so I'm not going to say it. There should be some kind of retribution. The Guardian should not allow this guy to spew hatred and lies under their banner.
And what was so amazing about it was he did it, and then he instantly blocked me. You know,
oh, God.
He said it and then he blocked me.
Oh,
and
God.
I was like, you know what? That's totally fine that you're going to do a hit and run that's going to stick. And then I'm going to have Pam Geller saying, you know, as said by this guy from The Guardian, that I have a career in this stuff. But all that stuff aside, like you don't get to just do that and then go along your merry way. And I think you do now, though. I think that in this day and age, there are no ramifications for your actions. And if people like you and I say, the Guardian needs to at least have him apologize, you know what I mean? They'd say, you're trying to stifle his free speech. You're trying to stop him from talking. I'm not trying to stop anyone from talking, but you can't just spew like misinformation about me and then go along your merry way with your paid job.
Right. No, I hear you. And, you know, okay, so his, you know, I just Googled him. I guess his Twitter handle is J.S. Trevino. Yes. Trevino, with a tilde over the N. And he is a self-identified conservative. But you know what? Everybody is despicable and odious. And
I've had conversations with like people who are like deeply right-wing Israeli who disagree with my very existence, who have never thrown that at me. So how is this right. Ginger from Texas doing this? I got nothing against gingers. My mother is one, you know, and she told me gingers are ashamed of this man right now.
What's a ginger?
A red hair. I love that you don't know what a ginger is. You don't want
my mother had red hair, but I never heard it was ginger. So I see your tweet, and this was just from 2 hours ago. He says, "What's ironic is you're the one on the side with the kill all the Jews people." You know, oh my God.
And that's based on me saying what journalist sources Wikipedia. Him saying he's not a journalist, and me saying, oh, I'm sorry, I got it wrong. Please go on and spew your hate.
Oh, my God. All right. Unbelievable.
He knew that, Nicole, this whole thing with me and you and radio or not, yeah. I'm just killing time. I just want you to feel safe. And then when you least expect
you're gonna kill me.
I'm going to insanguinate you.
Hold on. I can't. How dare you slam a really good person like Maysoon Zaid, who has never tried to kill me. You ass wipe. Sorry, I can't help myself, you know.
No.
And I'll be blocked soon as well.
I never used to curse on Twitter. And for the past like month and a half, I can't stop.
Uh-huh.
It's like I have my douche of the day every day.
Do you?
Yeah, every day there's a
cool.
douche.
Douche is not really cursing. You can actually say that on like over the air radio, and that is my criteria. As I tell my daughter, if you can say it on the radio, it's okay.
Right.
If you can't say it on the radio, then you're not allowed to say that word.
See, the vilification of the word douche is just all about the war against Massengo.
That's true, and the war against women. I mean, think about it. You know, Maysoon, shall we talk for just a moment, because we haven't gone there yet, about Paul Ryan?
I know.
And what a douche he is?
I'm so embarrassed, because as soon as I said the word douche, the first image that popped into my head was Paul Ryan.
Right. You and me both. What does that tell us?
Well, it tells you one thing, that like I feel very bad, because I always try when we're talking about like the candidates, like I never pick on Romney's religion, even though it's an easy target. I never
touch
it.
It really is.
And I try not to talk about Chris Christie's issues with weight. And then I have Paul Ryan with that hair. And I'm so sorry. I'm shallow, but that hair.
The hair. Well, he's Eddie Monster, you know.
Okay. Not only that, but did you notice that the gel in his hair is like, you can see it. He's like, it's like 1950 right there. I mean, it's really, really bad what's going on the top of his head. And I just don't trust a man who uses more hair product than his wife.
Do we know about his wife? You know.
Yeah, I saw her. She's got like nice loose blonde hair.
Okay.
I feel like Michelle Obama is just like, if I was Michelle Obama, I would just be so overwhelmed by the amount of blonde surrounding me. Because Anne, Jill, and
you're right.
The lucky woman who's married to Paul Ryan, whatever her name is.
Jenna or something like that. It's a Jenna or a Jana. You know, it's one of those kind of names. But the question is, are any of them real blondes?
I think Jill Biden is.
You think?
I do.
Okay.
I think so. I'm putting my money
on. We will
on
never Joe know, you know, unless you happen to be in a steam room with
him. I feel like Joey's cheap and he always rode Amtrak, and that she wouldn't be the type to invest in dyeing her hair.
I don't know about that.
I'm sorry. That was just random. I was talking like Joe Biden. No, I just feel like also like the Romney Ryan thing, the fact that they both like kind of sound alike.
Yeah.
It's like, it's just more of that creepy, like white fraternity boy attitude. I think that like everyone said Mitt Romney proved that he was a bully by picking this guy to be his pit bull. And that's it.
Okay, perhaps. But then again, there's, you know, he could have gone the Sarah Palin route. I think that Paul Ryan is Sarah Palin with a penis.
Right, because I was going to say, like, what's the difference between Sarah Palin and Paul Ryan? Like, he got picked on Saturday AM. Also, it's like, Romney, we understand you're on hip, but really, Saturday morning in the summer, no one's awake.
Well, that's the thing. And not only that, I mean, half the country was definitely still asleep on the West Coast. I mean, it was only 6 a.m. And they bilked everybody in, well, not me, but millions of people into getting that app for their phone. So they'd be the first to know when Romney was going to pick his VP, right? And so the news broke at like midnight on Friday night. And then they do the big photo op kickoff event on the USS Wisconsin. Right. Keep in mind that neither Romney nor Ryan have ever served a day in the military.
Right.
So that's kind of weird. But they do it at 9 a.m. So, you know, most people who had that stupid app on their phone slept through the whole thing.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a person who's like always awake. And I was in Washington, D.C., and I was like, what is this? I'm like, you announce the big vice presidential announcement at 9 a.m. on a Saturday. You sign NDAA at a time like
right.
that. This yep. is not the type.
Right.
But like within minutes of him, you know, choosing Ryan, I was already reading things online about all the skeletons this dude has in his closet. And then I listened to talk radio, you know, like Dennis
right.
Miller.
Oh, no.
I can't not listen to Dennis Miller.
Oh, no.
Miller.
How do you do
yeah.
that? How do
I
you
have
do
to.
That?
It's a good point of reference to see what's going on with the rest of the world. And I get to fulfill my Dennis fix because I used to love him before he went crazy. Dennis Miller.
Right.
Yeah, until he turned into Dennis Miller. No, before he turned into Larry Miller. And then I was like, wait, what happened?
Yeah.
You
yeah.
turned into the same guy. That's creepy. But they immediately started talking about how Ryan wanting to cut off Medicare won't affect seniors. If you're not born before 1955, you don't have to worry. And I'm like, how does that make me feel better in any way, shape, or
it
form
doesn't.
To hear this?
I know. Do they think that people my age, I mean, there's millions of people, and you know what I figured out? I am at the tail end of the baby boomer. So I was born in 1959.
Oh
so
my God.
I'm old. So I will be 53 in a couple of months. And so we're the ones who are going to get screwed the most.
I'm not saying, oh my God, because you look absolutely fabulous for your age, which is another reason why I would never kill you.
Thank you.
Also, because that's what I mean. The people who are born in like 1956 are like,
oh my God.
Excuse me? How is this good?
We are the ones who get screwed the most. I mean, everybody after us gets screwed too, but we get screwed the most. I've paid into Medicare and Social Security for my entire life, knowing that I can, if I just make it to 65, and now they want to pull that out from under me. I don't think so.
So why did Mitt Romney pick him?
I think he was told. I think the Koch brothers said, here's who will be your running mate.
And then we have Sheldon.
Yeah, and Sheldon too. Now, can we talk about the fact
that
Sheldon Adelson is the guy who funded that. Remember that documentary, King of Bane?
Yeah.
He did this for Newt Gingrich. This was Sheldon Adelson.
Yeah,
and
Sheldon
why
Adelson.
Nobody's talking about this, I don't know. But this was that 28-minute long documentary about the evils of Mitt Romney, funded by Sheldon Adelson. And now he will spend $100 million to get Mitt Romney elected? Excuse me, does anybody else see the problem here?
Well, that's why I feel like Sheldon Adelson isn't even like really sponsoring Mitt Romney. And I think that when Mitt Romney announced Ryan as president, it was not even a Freudian slip. It was just the reality is he knows he's not really anything but a figurehead. It's really interesting watching his entire party hate him and knowing why they do. Because why do you think the entire GOP hates Mitt Romney? Why?
Why?
Why do you think?
Because a number of reasons. One is, because he is not a conservative. They look at him as a liberal because he used to be fairly moderate. He was never a conservative. He was never far right until he decided to change his political viewpoint so that he could get elected. They don't believe him. They don't trust him. They don't like him. And he's not a Christian.
I think it's because he's not a Christian.
Right. He's a Mormon. And can I tell you,
everything else you can excuse, because the Tea Party, the conservatives, I'm not lumping all Republicans together because I know Republicans who are good people. I really do. I swear to God. And, you know, but these people who are always, always talking about, you know, these values and stuff, they forget every mistake that everyone else makes. You divorced your wife with cancer, that's totally fine. You used to be a Democrat and now you're a Republican, that's totally fine. But the fact that he's not a Christian is what they can't get over.
Right. They won't talk about
Obama
it and they don't want to go there.
Muslim,
right.
When he, in their minds, not
is a
mine,
fake Christian.
Is more of a Christian
right.
than Mitt Romney.
Right. Well, and that's true. This is sort of mind blowing. The fact is that they won't attack him on the basis of his religion, but they will attack Obama because of the church that he went to for all these years. And then, you know, they'll attack him for Reverend Wright, but then say, but he didn't believe his teachings anyway because he's a secret Muslim. Now, you know, and the question was always, so what if he were? I mean, he isn't, what if he was? Now, here's the thing. I got to tell you, the Mormonism, and I know you won't go there, and I understand why, but from somebody who was totally secular, I may be Jewish by heritage, but I don't have any religious beliefs. I'm an atheist. I don't believe there's some mythical being up there in the heavens who, you know, has any control over our lives or whatever happens afterwards.
This is like telling someone there's no Santa Claus. I have to believe in heaven. It's the only thing keeping me sane.
Really?
Well, my dad.
But I lost my parents.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. And they're dead. And I'm sorry. And you know what? I believe that their energy is still around me. I believe in the power of the universe, but I don't believe there's a God up there. I certainly don't believe that God somehow impregnated some virgin on earth and she
totally,
gave birth
yeah.
to his child. I mean, it's all mythology.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Yeah. I totally respect the fact that you don't believe in anything. I think that you respect the fact that, not that you don't believe in anything, but that that's your thought
right.
process. I think you respect the fact that I'm like, it's Ramadan. Yay. You know?
Yes. I respect anybody's choice to worship whatever God or whatever religion they believe in. That is your right. However, if you want to be in the White House, I think we need to know what your beliefs are. And the fact is that Mitt Romney, if he is a true believer, a true disciple of the Mormon Church, and he rose to not only bishop, but stake president, which is even above the bishops, where he oversaw a number
yeah.
of parishes or wards, they're called,
yeah.
and bishops, that we should know what his belief system is. And he honestly believes that, you know, he will become president. And when he's president, he will go to Jackson County, Missouri, which is where Jesus will return to earth and the two of them shall rule over the planet. He also
yeah.
believes that when he dies.
Does he really believe that?
Yes, this is what the Mormons believe. When they die, or
no,
someone.
Does Mitt Romney believe that?
He's a true believer. He is a believer. No, he doesn't believe he's the Messiah. He believes Jesus will return to Missouri.
During his presidency.
Well, yeah, that's what. I think during his presidency. Because, you know, that's why the Mormons really want one of theirs to be president, so that Jesus can return. And the Mormon president and Jesus, when he returns to Missouri, can rule over the world. Now, they also believe, and so
Israel plays a part in this, I'm sure.
I don't know. I know now the Christians.
It has to, because part of the Messiah coming back is the United Jerusalem.
Right. And that's it. But Mormonism is not Christians. I'm sorry. They're not.
Aww.
It's not a Christian religion. And so
they are Christians. They think they are.
Well, because they believe Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. But they don't believe Jesus was born of the virgin birth. But they do believe that they're all.
If a little boy thinks that he's a girl, he gets to be a she because he thinks he is. So they think they're Christians. So they get to be Christians because they say
okay.
they are.
All right. I don't know about that. But I also know that when Mitt Romney dies, he believes he will become a god and he will get his own planet to reign over. And his wife,
or wives, if he had more than one, would join him there on that new planet after they die, as his, you know, like servants. And I think the American people should know this.
Yeah.
I think people need to know what, you know, and I think when you're a Christian,
religion sounds crazy.
I do too. I'm sorry.
It all sounds
crazy. I'm with Bill Maher on this one.
Yeah. And that's why it's just like, if he can separate, I think the key is like, can you separate your beliefs from your governing? And we see those lines being blurred by them every day. And that's why you have, it's right to have a genuine concern about how their faith plays into how they rule, per se, because I think he does blur the lines. But I thought it was interesting when he governed Massachusetts, how many things he went against the church on.
Right.
Because it's so that does point towards the fact that he can separate church and state, and he's really just a puppet.
I don't know. You know, somebody on Twitter sent a note to both of us. Google lying for the Lord. Now, I've already talked about this. I knew about this.
Same as Muslim taqiyya, the idea that you can just, you know, in order to get people into the fold.
Really? So lie in order to further your cause?
But that's the same thing that people claim I do every day. In Islam, they call it taqiyya. And people claim every day that, like, I play this American hip role, but I'm really, like, showering in a veil, and I'm just doing it to seduce you guys into, you know,
right.
my crippling Sharia.
Of course.
So lying for the Lord is the same exact
thing. Wow. So it's like, you know, like Michelle Bachman is accusing Huma Abedin, and I accused you, actually, a few weeks ago when I was in for Randy. I had you on and said, you, I understand, are infiltrating the American, you know, comedy scene on behalf of the Muslim Brotherhood.
Yeah.
So that's what you're doing.
And I had inducted you into the Brotherhood, and you didn't even know it.
I know. Look at that. I don't know.
And she's not backing down, right?
No. In fact, she apparently one of her idols also won the Republican nomination in another congressional district in Minnesota. The world is going batshit fucking crazy.
It really, really, totally is. There's like no other way to put it than the way that you just did. Oh, by the way, and talk about people having to defend themselves when they shouldn't be defending themselves. President Barack Obama the other day had a pork sandwich with a beer in the middle of the day. Now, is that not screaming, I'm not Muslim?
Eating you think?
A pork sandwich and a beer in the middle of the day during Ramadan.
But you see,
like, can I get a what?
Right.
You know?
But you see, here's the thing. It's like Huma Abedin marrying a Jew and having his child. It's just all, you know, it's just all her way of lying for the Lord, basically.
You gotta lie for the Lord. It's what you gotta do. And look, you know, as soon as, like, I was never even considering voting for Mitt Romney. And you know that I'm not a fan of all of Obama's policies.
Right, me too.
After he put Paul Ryan next to him, there's no effing way I'm letting that thing be one heartbeat away from the presidency.
God.
Because I know that guy. I have met him everywhere.
Uh-huh.
I've interacted with a million Paul Ryans when I used to work on the campaigns of like Bob Torricelli and all the rest of these people that I worked with before I became disenchanted when I used to be a delegate. I've met people exactly like Paul Ryan, and there's nothing scarier than someone that's that blindly ambitious.
Well, exactly. You know, in high school, even he was in the
brown noser,
the biggest brown noser. Right. And, you know, and that's what Mitt Romney does. He says whatever he needs to say to move up the ladder. This is the Paul Ryan. He is that smarmy, like, he's so full of himself.
The hair.
Well, he's Eddie Munster. I mean, we know that.
A monster with a lifetime supply of jet.
Now, Maysoon Zaid is with us, and you live in New Jersey. So I got to ask you, why do people like Chris Christie?
I'm so proud. He's going to be the keynote speaker.
He's the biggest fucking bully.
In New Jersey. I don't know. I mean, don't you feel bad for me living in New Jersey? Because
because I live in Florida. I live in Florida.
Oh my God, you live in Florida. But my past three governors have been like a disgrace.
Uh-huh.
A total, utter disgrace. And one of them I worked side by side with for years, because I worked with Corzine for years and years with the Arab American community and as Dalgett and all these other things. And we had McGreevy before them. And now we have Chris Christie. And I think that all my girlfriends who work in everything from nursing to teaching are regretting the fact that they voted for Chris Christie.
Are
and
they
voted for Chris Christie because their husbands told them to. And their husbands are cops, and now those cops are also regretting the fact that they voted for Chris Christie. Because all of my friends that are teachers that are working in hospitals have lost their jobs. And I don't know anything about the economy. I don't know how it works. I'll admit it. I don't do math. I'm so sorry.
Uh-huh.
I understand, like, politics and ideology. I don't understand economics. But after he came into office, teachers are losing their jobs.
Yep.
Teachers' salaries are under siege. And out of the five hospitals that my mom used to manage, three of them got closed. One got bought out by, like, a Russian guy. And all the women who are working there don't know what's going to happen to their jobs.
Well,
and, like, my friends are now looking for places to have their children because hospitals that used to have maternity wards now are private hospitals that don't.
Unreal.
And it's a mess in New Jersey right now.
Wow. But yet his approval rating is high.
Because he's the guy that's likable.
But there's nothing like about him. There's nothing likable about him. He is a big, fat, ugly bully.
People from the Jersey Shore, they think that he's like them. You know, I have weight issues too. I can
identify. So do I. Hello.
No, I wasn't saying about me. I go to yoga.
No, I have weight issues. No, I have fought with my weight from day one. So no, I call him a big fat because he's ugly in spirit. He's ugly. He's a miserable, mean, horrible person.
I think he's miserable and mean. I think he knows very little about governing. I think that the way he treats his constituents is deplorable. And I understand, again, you just have to be like, what is the image that that party is trying to portray? And what they're trying to portray is bully.
Bully. We are mean. We have no compassion. We don't care about our fellow human beings. And yes, Paul Ryan is the perfect spokesperson for Ayn Rand's philosophy of me, myself, I. I got mine. Fuck you.
Exactly. And the way they translate it to get the minions to vote for them is, come on, come along with me. I'll make sure the brown people get screwed and you'll be fine. Because really, it's them that's screwing it up for you, not me.
Right, right. Oh,
that's
exactly.
That's what they're selling.
Yeah,
and the biggest brown man is Obama. He's like the kingpin of these brown people that are taking your job.
The sheriff is a nih.
He's not even American, dude. And he's just like those people that did 9/11. That is the message. It's not even sugar-coated. And having Chris Christie, the king of all bullies, at the pulpit, it's perfect for them.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. You know,
it's like, you just need that guy to come sing. What's his name? Ted Nugent to come and sing. And they'll be fine.
God. You know, and then they have the other haters, like people like Donald Trump. Now, this just crossed my Twitter stream. We heard Donald Trump was telling everyone he's got a big surprise plan for the RNC convention. He says, he tweeted, today I'm working on my big surprise for the RNC convention. Everyone will love it. And Gawker writes, the surprise will be some idiotic video where Trump fires an Obama impersonator. And sure enough, last night, Obama impersonator, or Faux-bama, if you prefer, Kevin Michael posted a picture posing with Trump, along with a caption urging his Facebook friends to be sure to watch the Republican National Convention. So that's going to be Donald Trump's big surprise. He's going to fire an Obama impersonator. Ay, ay, ay.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Right.
This is not a joke. This is one of the most powerful countries in the world. This is not a joke. Do people understand that, like, people across the world look at what we're doing and realize we don't even take, like, who's president seriously?
Yeah, they've got,
like,
to think we are a joke.
300 million people with absolutely no choice. And you're bringing... broken world. What
yeah.
are we doing?
Yeah. It's crazy, and it's gonna get worse. The opposite world stuff. You know, you've got the right who have been throwing bombs for so long. You know, just the hate and the vitriol that comes out with these comments day after day after day, and yet Joe Biden says something, granted, kind of stupid, but, you know, harmless, and go nuts. The faux outrage is almost comical. Well, it is comical.
Outrage.
If you listen to Jon Stewart, he hit the nail on the head.
Yeah.
You know,
it's the faux outrage.
It is. Well, let me find this one clip. I don't know if you saw Jon Stewart last night, but here, like, listen to this one. This is perfect.
The rhetoric on all sides can be hateful sometimes, but are the Republicans really that blind to the depth of their own vitriol?
Hello.
You won't believe how blind. Blinder than a man Joe Biden would publicly challenge to a staring contest.
Name one prominent Republican who even comes close to what, like, the Alan Graysons, the Harry Reids, the Joe Bidens come up with and spew to the American public. Nice. I can't think of one prominent Republican who talks the way that they talk.
Really? Oh, my God.
Let me ask you a question. Does the lake behind you have reflective properties?
Reflective properties. Sarah, here's a mirror. Oh,
you may find the answer.
Oh, he gets better.
She's
what?
Sarah Palin's upset. She's what? A sad, sad
Well,
Muppet.
She's been relegated, you know, to the parking lot at the convention.
Dude. She's turned into a nobody.
Well, it's she is terrible. A nobody. She is a nobody.
I know, but it's like, I mean... Honey Boo Boo gets more attention than Sarah Palin now.
Now, who's Honey Boo Boo?
Oh, my God. Yeah, okay. Honey Boo Boo is everything that is wrong with parenting today. Honey Boo Boo is a TV show on TLC.
Okay.
And I believe firmly, and many in television object to what I'm about to say, but I think that the Screen Actors Guild and AFTRA should step in and cover the children that are on these reality shows because they're being abused.
Yeah.
They're being exploited on national television. I love a good chuckle, but Honey Boo Boo is about this poor, like, little overweight, like person who's, like, really backwards. She's a little white girl from a family that is I don't know what to call them without insulting some sort of race or creed, but they're like these really backwards people who don't believe in education and believe in couponing and jumping in mud pits. And they made this girl, Honey Boo Boo, into a pageant queen. So they pimp her out in these pageants to win money. And like the girl, this little like 6-year-old girl, when she's not wearing makeup and hair, is like, really unattractive. Aww. And all of America is making fun of her because she's unattractive and backwards.
Oh my God.
And she'll do anything for a dollar. And she's always saying, I'll do anything for a dollar. And people don't realize she's a 6-year-old girl being exploited by her mother.
Oh,
and that
God.
This is psychological abuse. And
yes.
I'm all for fun, but this is not fun. We're watching a girl be scarred for life by her mother.
Wow. And TLC, this is the channel that used to be the learning channel, by the way, right? That now this is the channel that gave us, you know, K+8 or whatever.
+8.
Oh, my God.
But they also have a show about conjoined twins. That's like actually amazing, you know.
Really?
And I'm sure that they're exploiting them, too. But like, you know, the refugee was watching it and he was stunned. He was like,
the refugee, that would be your husband?
Yeah, I call him Chefugee. My Chefugee of a husband with his stereotypical job. He makes falafel. I'm like a walking joke. I can't. So this is what motivates me to kill.
Kill the Jews. Yeah.
Why is it okay for this girl? Like, she's mocked by everyone, and you don't feel like they're talking about a 6-year-old girl. You feel like they're talking about Kim Kardashian. And it's like,
who should be mocked?
A child. Exactly.
Right.
And who can fend for herself.
Right.
And my God, she's like more well known than Obama.
Right.
She is more, if you hold up both their pictures, more people can identify her ass than his face.
Oh, God. That's really sick. It really is sick. And what has Kim Kardashian ever done to be famous?
I'm not allowed to talk about those things.
You're not?
No, I'm totally kidding. I mean,
you'd have to kill me. You could tell me, but you'd have to kill me.
Yes. I've had this conversation with my agent because this comes back to my whole Crip Malkin rising thing.
Uh-huh.
There's only two ways that you can get famous. The reason I'm sitting on, you know, a couch in New Jersey, like counting coupons,
talking to me on the internet. Like, yeah.
No. I love you. You're thank God I'm on the radio with you. I'm lucky to be on with you. And you even put me on Randy Rhoads show.
Yes.
And I'm cursed. But the fact of the matter is that you have two choices as a woman. If you want to make it, you got to A, do a sex tape, or B, you gotta be dumb. And like, I can't seem to get myself to fit into either of those two categories. Because the women who are on TV right now, I'm not talking about everyone, but the people that we're talking about, have absolutely nothing in their heads, or they've made a sex tape. And the people who haven't made a sex tape, like Essie Cupp just got a job on MSNBC, and that girl used to flip her legs up on Fox News. What's the difference between that and having Ray JP on you? What's the difference?
I don't know. Essie Cobb, I'm sorry, makes me want to puke. Seriously, I cannot, I will not watch that show. I haven't attempted to. I wouldn't with her on it. I'm sorry. And it's because she's got, you know, I don't know, big boobs or something. I don't understand it. So, no, you're right. Will from Chicago in the chat room says, I'm sorry, the Kardashians make the Gabor sisters seem like Audrey and Kate Hepburn. You know, it's true. These women have done nothing, nothing. And I heard somewhere how much money Kim Kardashian made. And I say made, not earned, because she doesn't earn a dime. It's really sad. And it is sad that more people, you know, can identify her than Barack Obama.
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing. But there you have it. There you have it. But I'd rather have them attacking her who can defend herself than this child. Like, it's terrible. And nobody is looking out for these kids. And so, like I said, I'm not conservative. I laugh at everything. You know, we've had the conversation about me saying all is fair in jokes. Nothing is off limits.
Right.
But this child is being exploited. Her mother makes her drink a combination of Red Bull and Mountain Dew in order to get peppy for the pageant.
Oh, my God. Why is her mother not arrested for child
abuse? Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, we're watching this on TV as if what this woman's doing is not abusive because we think it's funny. Like, what is this? And why is it on TLC?
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
So, but like, I'll admit, let me say, I wear makeup on TV and I don't wear it in real life. I do my hair. I dress up. Like, I definitely play into the part.
Well, of course,
like,
you have
never
to
walk on TV without playing into that part. So I'm not saying that I don't do things that Essie Cupp does. I'm just saying that if I ever flip my legs up on the table, you know, during Countdown with Keith Olbermann, my mother would have broken them, and righteously so.
Right. 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 No, I hear you. And it is sad that that's what TV has devolved to, or those, you know, so-called reality shows. Have you seen Stars Earn Stripes?
No, I haven't.
Oh,
but
God.
I know that they fired Jack Osbourne because he has MS.
Oh, God. Jack Osbourne was on there? Oh.
Yeah, Jack Osbourne was supposed to be on it, and then he got cut, and his mother got all upset. Because she said that they fired him because he had MS, and they said because he has MS, he wouldn't be able to do the tasks. So, you know, that was what I knew about.
I'm sorry. War is not a game. It's not a TV show. People get killed. It's not funny. It's not fun. It's not sexy. You know,
Nicole, I know you're going to need to, sorry to interrupt.
Yes, go ahead.
I know you're going to need to wrap up.
Yes.
So just shout out, quick thing. Everyone can find anything they want on maysoon.com.
Yes.
And don't forget to tell The Guardian what your thoughts are.
Absolutely.
And then the last thing is, I want everyone to Google a guy named Peter Singer, because I'm an embarrassed disabled person that didn't know about this schmuck before.
I don't know about him. What?
There's a guy named Peter Singer, and about 20 years ago, he came up with this like theory that parents should be allowed to destroy their babies if they're born disabled within like a certain amount of time after birth. because since you can have an abortion before, why not be able to kill them after?
Oh my God.
And he really, really, really means this. But he's also an animal ethicist, and he's a real hero in like vegetarian and PETA world, right?
Oh my God.
And just a week ago, or a little bit more than a week ago, don't quote me on the time, but just recently, he came out advocating another thing called the Ashley treatment. And the Ashley treatment is the concept of stunting the growth of profoundly mentally disabled children so that they're easier to carry around and they don't get big and burdensome. And
oh,
he also advocates this. So my lesson for the week is please Google Peter Singer, because if anyone's a bigger douche than Josh Trevino, it's Peter Singer.
Okay, Peter Singer, that's on your list for today. Maysoon, I got it. So now I know Huffington Post started their new live channel. By the way, nobody asked me if I want to do a show on there. But
let's do a show on the air. Come on,
let's
Huffington
do it. Okay, who do we talk to? How do we get a job?
How do we get involved?
How do we get a job is what I said.
It's all on the websites. They have a thing called HuffPost Jobs, which I've signed up to. Listen, I'm obsessed with Huffington Post Live.
Are you?
I do think that it's the next generation of how news is going to be told.
Really?
And I'd rather be a part of it than watch it go down the tubes as quickly as, you know, so many other things
right.
do. I think it's really cool. I think they might be trying too hard to be young and hip and don't maybe have enough substance yet. I'd like to see more substance.
Hold on. I just opened it up and it's playing a commercial. Okay, so but they have people who work for them. They have their own set shows, right?
Yeah, they have shows from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. and they interact with the community a lot. And they interviewed me the other day about jokes. If it's ever too soon to tell jokes about 9/11. And I've put it on and I've had it like run and I can listen to it, but I want to see more depth. Right now it's really hip.
And they only start at 10, so they need a morning show.
At 10 p.m. they need a morning show, and who better than frickin' Frack?
There you go. All right. Get your agent on it. You have an agent, right?
I do. I have the best agent in the world, Jeff Lash, William Morris Entertainment.
Okay, well, Endeavor. Tell him to do this.
Endeavor, sorry.
Okay, come on. Let's get a job here.
I would love to get a job. And you know what? We could have an ongoing theme where I try to kill you in every episode.
There we go. It works for me. You know, we can even do the, you know, a Palestinian and a Jew do a morning show.
Oh, God, no, please. No God. You have to promise me that that will never be in any press release.
Okay.
It's just able-bodied and disabled.
Okay.
That's what we are.
Really?
That's
no.
what we're opposites. We're able-bodied and
okay.
disabled.
Okay, there you go. All right. Well, however they want to do it, I'll horn myself out. I need the money.
I'm ready. I'll spin around the
let's
pole.
Do let's do it. All right. We'll talk later. We'll talk later. All right. All right. So we have an assignment here.
Happy Eid. It's Eid. It's the end of Ramadan.
It is?
Yes, you can eat again.
Oh, you can eat again. I never stopped.
I can eat at sunrise any night.
Okay.
Sunset. Yeah. So anyway, Nicole, thank you for having me on.
Thank you.
And I will see you on HuffPost Live.
Okay. It's a date.
We'll call it Chick Point.
Chick Point. We'll work on that one. All right. Bye. Maysoon Zaid, everyone. Maysoon.com and at Maysoon Zaid on Twitter. And that does it for us for today. And for this week on this show, I'm in for Randy Rhodes this afternoon and tomorrow. All right, so don't forget. See you at RandyRhodes.com or, you know, on the air. And back here Monday. Bye. Thanks, everyone.